Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Mason Dambrot. We're here today with Jesse Prinz, culturalist, neurophilosopher, and distinguished professor at the City University of New York in the Graduate Center. Hi, Jesse.
Hi, Stuart.
We're going to discuss now nature and nurture, specifically evolution and culture. And as some of our viewers might know, it's a long-standing debate. Do we owe our consciousness, our mind, our thoughts, what makes us human, largely to genetics or largely to the environment? And from what I've read in your material, you have a very interesting take on this. And so perhaps you could start by just telling us your basic thoughts about nature and nurture. And that, and specifically, after reading Jesse's material, I can no longer in good faith refer to this as nature versus nurture. They're inextricably bound. And with that, if you don't mind.
Thanks. Yeah, great topic for contemporary science because it's a place where the advent of neuroscience, the advent of modern genetics, but also advances in psychology have really led to new insights into how nature and nurture work together. Everyone in the field will tell you it's both. And I think the real debate continues to exist because people are going to place emphasis in different places. And for any given human capacity, they're going to say, okay, nature is doing most of the work, nurture is doing most of the work. Disagreements will arise locally. And for me, really, the interest of the human story is the nurture side. Mm-hmm. So I think the human story begins where nature stops. To tell the nature side is important, and it's what we share with lots of other creatures, but what's distinctive about us is our capacity to learn and to change behavior as a result of experience. And I think there isn't a single human capacity that isn't touched by this. So we think about things as basic as our emotions or our personality traits, things that we really think are inherited. And we look at them, and sure enough, there is a biological contribution, but we see again and again ways in which socialization plays a role in shaping these things. So whether you're outgoing or extroverted, may depend to some extent on biology, but can also be amplified, altered, reshaped by experience.
So then for you, if I take it correctly, that learning is not just, as some people might infer, learning how to speak another language. It's cultural learning. And then it's certainly, in your view, and how can I disagree, it's not any form of biological determinism. If anything, it's contextual, some say predispositions, or perhaps a situation where a genetic expression could lead to a trait that depends on a particular environmental interaction to manifest. Is that going in the right direction?
I think that's right, though I think even the word predisposition may push things too much towards the to the nature side. And the reason for that is if you think about something like alcoholism, to take one example, and describe it as a predisposition, what you're in effect implying is that a person is born with this inner state that is driving towards alcoholism. It's kind of like a vehicle with a destination. And it may or may not get there, and everyone admits that environment can play a role, but it sounds like it already has this endpoint in mind. But biology isn't that. So when you say somebody has a predisposition to alcohol, the more accurate thing to say is that there are certain biological constitutions that make people more or less susceptible to certain environmental factors that could eventuate in a trait.
So in the case of alcoholism, it's the genetically expressed metabolic processes by which the level of alcohol imbibed has different effects on different people, something to that effect.
That's right. And the effects, importantly, can be highly varied. So somebody who's very low in their alcohol tolerance may be vulnerable to alcoholism because they just have a biological system that has a very strong reaction to this drug. So if the drug can produce addiction, somebody with a low tolerance may be more likely to end up with an addiction. But a person with a very high tolerance is also vulnerable because the person with a high tolerance may consume more of the drug in order to become inebriated, and as a result, they're exposing themselves to this toxic element. So I think when we look for the biological bases, we may find they're extremely varied in nature.
So quite right. Like in many things, there could be these thresholds that are expressed in this case, for example. And if that threshold is exceeded, whether it's volume or frequency or whatever it might be of exposure to an environmental effect, that could lead to the manifestation, as opposed to my erroneous statement of a predisposition.
Absolutely. And take somebody who we would say is not predisposed, somebody with just an average tolerance to alcohol. They can become alcoholics too. If they've had enough exposure, alcoholism will ensue. So do we say then that everyone has a predisposition?
I think the
language of predisposition implies that some people are vulnerable and others are not. In this case, like many others, we're all vulnerable, and that variation in vulnerability is better described in terms of things like variation in alcohol tolerance, which are among many factors that can lead to these outcomes. Being raised in a broken home, being raised in a community where you're exposed to other alcoholics, even things as simple as access to a liquor store may be huge players here. In fact, there's some evidence that proximity to a liquor store is a bigger determinant of alcoholism than any biological trait.
Oh, that's very interesting. And that is something I wanted to get into, that oftentimes different types of evaluations, intelligence tests that decades ago were naively but notoriously exclusionary. The social environment, the socioeconomic environment always seemed to me to place a much greater role in learning and development than it was given credence to do. And if I'm correct, I hear something like that in what you're saying.
Yeah, I think intelligence is a good example, because we really, I think, had bought into a view that intelligence is biologically fixed. We see a long legacy of people being excluded admission into the United States because they were thought to be part of groups that were low in intelligence. There was mandatory sterilization for women who were deemed low in intelligence
for
fear that their children would be low in intelligence. And what we've seen with the science of intelligence is that the story is much more complex. And while there may be biological factors that lead to some of the variation we see in intelligence, intelligence is one of the most plastic traits we can imagine. Every year of schooling increases IQ. So take the basic standardized test for assessing intelligence, and you can move around scores just by environmental exposure and learning.
That is really, everything you say is interesting, Simon. I think I'm repeating that too much. But I do remember a recent quote was saying that that the effect of environment and genetics in educational attainment are pretty much, this person was saying in any case, 50-50, except that's only true if you obviate, if you ignore the socioeconomic context. Once you include that, and then you map those achievements to socioeconomic background, whether it's poverty, whatever it might be, then it's 10%, 10% genetics and 90% environment.
Yeah, in fact, it can even be as low as 1%. So if you really think about it, what goes on in a lot of these genetic tests is they take very, very stable uniform environments. And they say, okay, given a very healthy, positive environment, a middle-class environment with good education,
that's what this was, yeah.
How much is biology
explaining
the variance? And there you might see pretty impressive numbers. Maybe 50% of the variance will correlate with a biological variable. Go to an environment that's more varied, go to a lower economic status, and you'll start to see environment playing a much bigger role. So if you're a poor kid growing up in a difficult environment, whether or not you end up with a high IQ is going to depend much more on whether you have a committed mentor, whether you have a parent who's staying at home, whether you meet an influential peer who's shown some educational achievement. These little factors of biography that are not repeatable are going to be doing the lion's share of causal work in determining your educational and intellectual outcome.
So let me just make a segue. There's so much I wanted to ask you. What are your views about the reassertion recently over the past few years of the effect of Lamarckian evolution? There was a study at Stanford just last year, one at Tufts in 2009, that at least made tentative claims. The one in 2011 actually was more aggressive, that in fact some of what they found in terms of learning, plasticity, and some other effects were, to their mind, evidentiary in terms of the at least a strong possibility that Lamarck was right after all in some limited ways.
Good. So I, just to give a little background, I mean, we do see in this debate between Darwin and Lamarck a difference in whether a learned or acquired trait can be passed on through biological material. And it looked like with the rise of genetics that the Darwinians had won. Lamarck was ruled out. But there's been an exciting new research program, some of it looking at what's called epigenetics, that show that your genes can be changed by your environment. So environment doesn't just change, say, what you've stored in your brain, what information you've acquired. It's actually changing the biological material, the underlying genetic code that's going to affect your behavior. Now, once biological material is affected, it has the possibility of being biologically transmitted. So we can start to see in principle how an acquired trait, something changed by the environment, can then be passed on through biological means.
I see. By affecting the silencing of genes or reactivation of duplicate codons or something to that effect.
Yeah. I do think we want to be cautious in overemphasizing this this finding, because at this point we really don't know much about what these Lamarckian forms of acquisition do for us. We know very little about how epigenetic changes are involved in human behavior. So we really at this point can't get overly excited about these findings in biology. But in a certain way, they're almost irrelevant. They're irrelevant because we already have something that's very much like Lamarck that's been known for a long time, which is culture. So the environment that we inherit, culturally speaking, is not part of our biological makeup, but it is something that can change in one generation and be transmitted to the next. Because human beings are changing their environment so much, and because environment is so important to human learning, we are remarkably Lamarckian creatures. We are creatures whose outcomes depend on the achievements of our previous generations.
I'm sorry to cut you off, but I had that epiphany just that when you said that. Lamarckian creatures is beautifully put and very well said. Okay, and just to clarify for myself, I must admit, so the epigenetics we're talking about in this context is not the methylation that has certain effects, but more of the effect on expression or silencing, perhaps, of various traits that can then be passed on or not.
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.